A special webinar with Alex Collier, presented by Wolf Spirit TV, in association with AlexCollier.org. Afternoon, good evening, and good morning, or wherever. Come on, camera, lights, action. Good afternoon. This is JP. This is what I look like. It's horrible. I know. Never mind. But I've tried to make myself look presentable enough to present our very special guest on what is probably the first in a multitude of webinars and educational events which Wolf Spirit Radio, which will become Wolf Spirit TV, which will become Wolf Spirit Media Network, will bring in over the next few months and years to help you move through these shifting times. And so, to that end, good afternoon. We are today speaking to Alex Collier. And without any further ado, everybody knows who you are. Alex, good afternoon.
Hey, JP. Thank you.
How are you, my friend?
I'm good. Hi, everyone. Thank you for supporting this. This is the first time I've done anything like this, and I'm a little technically challenged, but here we are, and I just want to say thank you very much for supporting this, and if this is something... if there's enough positive feedback, you know, maybe we'll do another one here. We'll just have to see how this goes. I have to stick to 90 minutes because I am in a library here in Colorado, and I only have the room for that amount of time. So we'll just get right to it. A couple of notes, personal things up on top, up in front, and that is that I get a lot of emails from people who want me to sign up on LinkedIn, and I don't do the social media thing. I know that there's a Facebook page. That is not me. That is a tribute page someone else has done entirely on their own. So I have nothing to do with that, and I just want you to know that I don't. It's not that I don't want to or I'm ignoring you, but when you contact me through that page, I have to join the page in order to tell you no. So I'm not going to do that. So now you know. For those who are trying to get on and for some reason haven't gotten the link, when this is over, we will contact you and give you the ability to see the rebroadcast of it, or whatever it's called. Okay. We're going to talk about some things today. We're going to do some current stat of where things are, in my humble opinion, and we're also going to talk about some information that I've been sitting on for 25 years, simply because I didn't want to deal with it. I didn't want to go there. But you know, when you look at the stage of the world and the way the stage is being set, to create chaos and to throw everybody into fear and panic, I'm getting very clearly that it's time to address this issue, or at least give you the Andromedan perspective of this issue. And you know, we're about to, and I know things are really weird out there, very strange, but we're about to get into a whole new level of weirdness in the world. So let's let's start off with the historical piece and get that out of the way. Now, in addressing this issue with you, I want you to understand this is the Andromedan perspective. For myself, I'm still not 100% clear on it, and I still have questions. And I will tell you what those questions are and why I even have them. Okay, now, when I was a kid, one of the very first things once a relationship had been established was, is there a God? And they've always referred to it as the isness. Many people call it creator. It goes, whatever this essence is, it is real. It exists. It exists to us on third density, it exists on fourth density, fifth density, and I assume it goes all the way up to 11th or 12th or whatever new dimensions there are at this point, because evolution continues. It never stops, all right? And even though it seems really fast to us here, it's ridiculously quick on other dimensions, okay? Because they don't deal with time and space the way we do. And their vibration is, of course, a lot higher, so therefore things move much quicker. And being born into those densities, they've learned to adapt. They're able to, it just works for them, okay, because they're used to that. Now, I also asked about Jesus, having been born and raised a Catholic. And if you've done, those of you who have done any due diligence or have researched the church, no less than 7 popes have said this whole thing was a myth. And if you looked at the creation of the Church of Rome, or the government of Rome, which became a Church of Rome, it's dubious at best, okay? The fact that they started with 1,800 bishops from all over the known world at that time, and no less than 1,500 of them were excommunicated because they wouldn't go along with the plan. So, having said that, during my conversations with them, one of the questions I asked was about Jesus. And their perspective is, and always has been, that the biblical Jesus was a composite character. And the importance of bringing this up will come when I'm done explaining this. It is their perspective, having looked at our history, that the only person that semi-matched part of that criteria was a rabbi by the name of Yeshua Malathiel, or Jesus Malathiel. He was married at age 13. His wife's name at the time was Mary. They had children. I don't know about the bloodline per se, okay, and there's plenty of interesting stories around all of that. But this Jesus Malathiel was a militant. He was a rebel. He didn't appreciate what Rome was doing. He didn't appreciate the suppression of the Jewish and the Israeli people or any of the people in that area at that time, whether they were Jews or not. What's interesting is, in their perspective, this man wasn't crucified and actually ended up in his later years at Masada. And where Masada is, there is an area called Cave of the Bones, or Cave of Bones. It is the Andromedan perspective that this rabbi, Jesus Malathiel, that his bones are in that cave. And he is the elder of all the bones. He is the 70-plus aged person that was found in the cave. There were also scrolls there that were retrieved and scored away that were written by Jesus Malathiel. And the last name was Malathiel. They say that this is the only person in history that fits that persona, okay, even though he wasn't all of these other things. It was also this Malathiel who Constantine's mother went to look for because she wanted to know if it was all true. So I present that to you because I have grave concerns that the powers that be are going to stage the second coming. This has also been said by Morinet that they have the technology in order to do this with the help of the consortium of regressive ETs that are here. By setting the stage and creating all of this negativity, all of this fear, you know, you create the problem, and then you come in with the solution, and the solution is a savior, okay? That doesn't explain, however, what I've just shared with you. That doesn't explain the Shroud of Turin or the image that's on the cloth of St. Teresa or the veil, okay? Or St. Veronica, I'm sorry, I think it's St. Veronica. And what's interesting is, okay, were those both created holographically? It has been suggested that the Shroud of Turin has, but I don't know about the veil of Veronica. What's interesting is that the blood type is the same on both of those cloths. So this is where I have a bit of confusion, okay? What I do know is that we all come from Creator, okay? We all come from Creator. Our souls come from Creator. And at this particular time in my life, and I think many of you would agree, it doesn't make sense to have an intermediary. The church has planted itself in the middle of everything. And if you're familiar with the work of Santo Bonacci, where he talks about the three trusts that the Vatican created, where they not only own the earth, but they own us and they own our souls, that's a real problem for me. And it should be for everybody, because it's nothing more than a government. And I bring this up because things are escalating very quickly. And I know that there are many speakers out there, great speakers, intelligent speakers, speakers with the highest of intentions who are sharing information that, you know, the war is over. That simply isn't true. The war is not over. It will not be over until the last one's gone, because they show no signs of surrendering. Okay? Lower management of this New World Order, they're scrambling like there's no tomorrow, because they're completely exposed and they're being handed over. As people are awakening, they're being handed over. The problem with that is that if you go with the Orion model, and I've spoken about this in the past, if you go with the Orion model, what happens is the very top echelon, what they do is they'll kill one or two layers of lower management, so there's no one left to tell the story. This is what's occurring now, okay? We're going to get help on this, and we have been getting some help, but I don't want you to think you can sit back and not pray and not meditate and not focus your intention on creating a benevolent expression of joy for Earth. It's not time for that. I mean, we have to actually really kick it up. We need to fully engage in the process of bringing enlightenment to the Earth. There is no way that we cannot do this, okay? And we're going to button up with that about, you know, engaging and again, bringing in a benevolent expression of joy to the Earth. In moving beyond the religious thing, 3 years ago we talked about a large planetary body entering the solar system. It's coming, folks. It absolutely is coming. And they're not going to say anything until they absolutely have to. And there is a lot of equipment being moved into our solar system to join what's already here. Now, at last count, there were at least 60 motherships here. I know that in the rings of Saturn and in the asteroid belt, or the bracelet, as the Sumerians used to call it, there was old mining equipment and other very large craft that were left there. Now, this isn't junk. These things actually still work after tens of thousands of years. Okay, they don't build planned obsolescence. These things work unless they're damaged or they're destroyed. That equipment also has been moved closer into Earth. However, it is in the infrared spectrum where we can't see it with our visible eyes. And the whole idea of this equipment being moved in is to mitigate the gravitational field and pull of this very large planetary body coming in. As it comes around the sun, it's going to come up in over on top of us. The idea is to create a shield above us to reflect this incredible gravitational field. Now, that doesn't mean we're not going to experience movement. My understanding is that we will. To what degree, I have not been told. To what degree we would experience movement or earthquakes. I also want to share with you that in the Andromedan perspective, there's a lot of talk today amongst everybody on the planet about Yosemite. Yellowstone. That it's a supervolcano that it's going to blow. I have been told emphatically it wouldn't blow. That basically what's going to happen is the inner Earth supervolcano that is feeding Yellowstone is underneath Calexico, California, in Mexico. That's where it is. And through lava tributaries, it makes its way through Nevada, Arizona, Utah, to Yellowstone. Well, as things start to go and it builds up, what it's supposed to do, and they have seen this, it is supposed to blow the back out of the San Andreas Fault. And that will immediately relieve the pressure, and Yellowstone will not go. Okay? I have heard absolutely no change to that scenario or plan whatsoever. And they were pretty emphatic that that's just what it's going to be. Okay, so I wanted to put that to rest, because a lot of folks send me stuff, and only recently have I really been able to get to all these emails, and I'm doing my best to get in touch with everybody and get back to everybody who's helped me with the car scenario, my truck, my Rover, and just everything. I cannot tell you what it means to me that you have supported me in this way, and there will be some reciprocity. I promise you there will be reciprocity. Still going through, still trying to get out of these hard patches. And I will. I'll get through these. You know, Earth is such an amazing place. It's a school of discernment. At the same time, it's a university of experience. There's just nothing like it. And many occasions I've asked Mornay if he wanted to change places with me, and he was not at all interested in doing that. And I understand, because it's a very tough school. We see it from one perspective where, you know, we're used to this, and it's just, okay, this is a day, this is what we have to deal with, this is just what it is. Our space families, they don't see it that way. They're like, wow, you know, what you guys go through, what you tolerate, the patience that you have is just extraordinary. But it's time to take things, I think, to another level. We need to kick things up here. As far as what's happening off-world, my understanding is that there's somewhat of a stalemate. Now, I'm encouraged to hear that some of the people that were on our space colonies on Mars, and I understand that soon there'll be some others that'll be coming forward that have been returned to Earth they're coming forward and they're telling their story. I think it's great that we need to, that we have this new perspective. To my knowledge, no one who's actually been part of the fleet and has been out there has actually returned to Earth to talk about what they know. And I do know for a fact that benevolent forces have tried to, and in some cases, engaged with them to give them another perspective of what's actually happening here and actually what their mission is or isn't. You know, on every level of this holograph, that's this reality that we think we live in, there is a different lie, okay? And if you can, and if you can grasp how that works, you know, we think reality is what we see every single day. Those who were taken off-world during the brain drain of the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and taken to other places, whether that be the motherships we've created, or colonization of other worlds that we haven't been told about, or Mars, they're living in another reality, okay? Though some of those have memories of Earth, but now they're so absorbed in another reality that they are almost disconnecting themselves from Earth, from us, our humanity. And then there's those who work in the Black Projects where they don't interact with humanity anymore. They essentially just interact in the hive mentality with the regressive ETs. They're in a completely different reality as well. And there's multiple layers here. This has all been done to divide us, to separate us from each other. Humanity has a soul. Just as Earth has a soul. They're doing everything they can to separate us into pieces, because by doing that, it weakens us. Because collectively as a soul, we are an incredible force, a dominant force. And I don't mean this in the sense of I don't mean this in a military sense where we can just bulldoze and do whatever we want. I don't mean it like that. We have a unique experience of, again, falling into time through different layers of physicality to third density. We have the unique experience of having this incredible extremes of emotions, from anger to apathy to joy, from apathy to compassion, from anger to love. And they are extreme. And we don't appreciate how incredibly strong we are. Because the world, the reality that they have created for us, this holograph, is all about really beating us down. It's about suppression. It's about making you conform to this box that they say we have to be in. 25 years ago, when I and others started speaking, you know, we were kooks, nuts, the list goes on, okay? You don't hear that too much anymore, because much of what we were talking about has become mainstream. And it is becoming mainstream because the rest of humanity is getting it. It's seeping in. Now, there have been people who have talked about the electronic fence around the Earth, where many people who were very good telepaths, I don't want to use the word channel. I've never really appreciated that word at all. But let's just say telepaths who were, receiving information from higher realms. when that net, that electronic fence, was put around the Earth, much of the information changed. And that's because you weren't talking to the same entities or energies. Okay, there was an intercession. There was they just started screwing with everybody. Okay. Well, when the benevolent ships come into our atmosphere, what they will do is they will purposely sit inside that electronic fence, and they will burn holes in that fence. And as long as they're sitting there, information gets in and out. It isn't necessarily coming from the ships, but, you know, on the higher dimensions, they know what's happening here. Okay, this, there's a, what's happening not only here on Earth, but in other star systems. This is a really big deal. You know, this is like a showdown of soul beings and those who are, let's say, not necessarily have soul or have fragmented soul, but also AI, artificial intelligence, that believes itself to be superior. It's a combination of things, all right? It all comes down to frequency, resonance. The separation of resonances is occurring, and it's about to get really profound. So when I say we're going to be moving into another level of weirdness, I am not exaggerating. Okay, it's going to get really strange. And what's important for you, for everyone, in my humble opinion, is for you to have perspective, is to not, if you can, not get caught up in all this make-believe, pretend, and created drama, because that's what they want. They want to draw our focus away from the spiritual path. And that's where most people are going. Now, whether any of the religions are true, whether they're not true, they are true, your connection to Source is absolutely paramount. That is what everybody needs to be working on, if you're even interested in evolving. Never surrender it. Never put anything or anybody, whether it's a savior, whether it's an alien, an ET, it doesn't matter. Never put anybody between you and the Source, the Creator. This is the message that I want to try to drive home here today, because as things get strange, as they start really tweaking the holograph with fake images, with all kinds of created drama, you're going to find your ground, you're going to find your center in Creator, in grounding yourself, in the fact that you are connected to the Source. You always have been. It's imperative that you remember that. And for me, and I've had a lot of challenges, I still have a lot of challenges, you know, nature does it for me. It grounds me right away, and I can get into that silence, and I can connect, okay? I can't always hold it for a long time, and everybody has a different place, whether it's a water fountain in the middle of the city, whether it's just leaning on a tree, whether it's sitting in a park or watching children or a bicycle ride or just a long drive in the country in your car without the music on and the windows open. Whatever it takes for you to be connected, you have to focus on that. Or I'm asking you to focus on that. Okay. Now, you know, I had all this planned out, and of course when it starts, it does what it does.
That's okay. Do you need to take a little break, Alex?
No, I'm good. I'm good.
Okay.
the Earth, while all of this stuff is going on, the Earth is also moving through our galaxy. Now, I've heard a lot of different things, or people have sent me stuff. One of these things is something about an ascension sometime here in September. Okay? September 28th, I hear. I personally don't give that any credence because we're not ready. We're not ready yet. What's happening, though, here, September, October, is that our solar system begins its descension, its descent into the galactic plane, which is an enormous plasma, electric plasma field. This will begin to trigger and turn on our DNA, our dormant DNA. Now, there are children being born in with three strands. Now, to my knowledge, there's only one that's actually been admitted, and that was in England, of a young boy who's come in with three strands. There are others, but they weren't born in hospitals. They were born with midwives at home. That's what their parents were guided to do. And these children are enlightened. They will be moving very quickly once we get enveloped into this field. I understand that they will be going to a fifth strand lightning quick. Many of us, especially us adults, will be moving to a third strand, some to a fourth, depending upon the condition of our physicality, how many toxins we have in it, our history of taking pharmaceutical medicines, things like that. Not everybody is going to make it through this cloud, I've been told. It's going to be extremely difficult for men to actually process this new energy. Now, this energy, from what I've been told, is going to be a movement that is going to appear very fast. It's almost going to be like you're hyperventilating or on speed, or if you've had way too much coffee. It's going to be an excelled adrenaline rush. Those are the things that it's supposed to feel like. The reason I stress connect to spirit, to soul, is because that's where we have to go with this energy, because that's what the energy is. Okay? This energy is what it is. It can't be tampered with. The only thing that could disconnect you from this energy, this field, this force, is here, okay, is fear. And this is why you're seeing things being kicked up quite a few notches now, because the powers that be, they still have quite a bit of control here, folks, those who actually rule the planet. Okay, they're not running for cover yet. They still think they've got everything locked down. You know that they, you know, even if they get rid of levels of management, you know, they're pretty confident that they can find others who will be drawn into the lure of greed, and they will, you know, they can have more minions to do what they need to do. It's interesting. Really extraordinary, to be honest with you, the things that are coming. To be able to detach from the drama, whether it's the presidential race, ISIS, all these different things, is going to take some practice, because they want our attention. Okay, remember, what keeps fueling this holograph is our focus on it. the Andromedans in the past talked about creating a domain of knowing. The Magna Carta started that with the lords and knights and others wanting some kind of rights against the king. You know, where the king just couldn't do anything he wanted whenever he wanted. Out of that came a series of experiences which led to the United States Bill of Rights, truly the first of its kind. That created a domain of knowing. And that, you know, went around the world. It's used in television shows, etc. And, you know, there's all kinds of young people who get arrested in Europe and other places who say, you know, I have rights. And it's because they've seen this in the movies and television, and they don't realize that in actuality in their countries they don't have rights. Well, some countries have implemented rights. But the point is that there's an awareness now that they want rights, and they have rights as a human being, not to be treated like cattle and chattel and a natural resource. What we can do individually and as groups is we need to focus on creating another domain of knowing. And that is the expression of benevolent joy, okay, or benevolent expression of joy. Joy being one of the highest forms of love that there is, an expression and one that all of us share together. Now, there is no one leader for this. There can't be one leader for this. This is something everyone individually needs to grasp and to embrace with their own intent, their own focused intent to do this. And in doing this, not only do you become a leader, but you become an expression of that which you're creating, this benevolent expression of joy. And it is very, very contagious. And it is the opposite polarity of what the powers that be are trying to create on Earth, which is fear and fear and just everything that's associated with fear. Did you guys want to take a break because you need to tell me something? JP?
No, you can keep going. I tell you what's interesting is that there are a few questions that have come into the chat room. I'm getting a list of questions for the top of the hour, but a lot of them, actually, you've covered the answers to them. So people who have asked questions about these things, Alex has actually covered some of these points. So just keep going, and I'm sure that you know, Spirit will move you to say the right things.
Okay.
And to serve all the people. And it's interesting what you were just saying about the encoding of the voices of people who are in this process. It's actually in the sounds of the voice that these frequencies are coming across, isn't it? Emoto, you know, you change the crystallization of the water in the body.
I'm exactly right, and that, I mean, that's how powerful we are, that, you know, we can change physicality, matter, because we're creating matter all the time. The deeper we go into the belief systems that, okay, this is the way it is, well, that's what it's going to be. I mean, you have to remember that and I've heard this used, this expression, Earth's a prison planet. It is not. We could easily make it that if we buy in to all their bullshit. Okay, they would love nothing more than to have us enslave ourselves, because you know, then we keep feeding this third density holograph that they want, that they're living off of. You know, there's some extraordinary movies that are out there. Jupiter Ascending is one that I find very interesting. John Carter, where he's talking to the Thurn, is another one. And I know that there's some other, The Giver is another one where they're talking about things that we're sharing here, and you know, they're trying to tell us, you know, the message is there. They're trying to tell us, they just can't be overt about it, because what's happening is, as the powers that be, and they're not all human, let's be clear about that, as they start dropping the veil or dropping the lid down on everything to suppress and imprison and enslave, the minions are beginning to realize they're stuck just like everybody else. They're beginning to see what the end agenda is, and it has not been what they've been told all along when their help was solicited. You know, and this is where I'm talking, where I talk about the lie on all the different levels. And I'm not the first to talk about this. I believe Richard Hoagland was the youth that was the first to actually express this, that there's a lie, a different lie under every level. And I'm not sure if he was talking about government, black ops, NASA, you know, or if he was just talking the entire encompassed area of what we know as reality. But he was right either way. It's there, and those on those levels above who believed that they were privileged, they're now realizing there is no privilege. You know, the only ones who are privileged are those at the very top. Everybody else is expendable. And now there's a lot of friction, and there's a lot of pushback, and this is good. And so with that comes the fact that we're seeing a lot of this information coming out, not only in mainstream, but movies, television, more and more books. It's becoming more and more prevalent. My concern is that people aren't paying attention to those messages, that they're not actually grasping and moving into a place, a perspective, well, what if this is true? In talking about, you know, religions, you know, do we actually need religions? No, we don't. And I know I'll catch some flack, but I've always caught flack for this. No, we don't need religions. Okay, spiritual practices, quieting of the mind, creating focused intent on your life, on your personhood, on source. Yes, but that's not a religion. Okay, we don't need religions. And if you really look at all of them for what they are, you have got to walk away with the idea that they're broken. They've become incredibly wealthy on the gullibility of everybody, and they damn sure haven't solved a single problem in the world. Okay, if anything, they've complicated the problems. And I've been saying this since the get-go. Okay? Off-world. Let's go back to off-world. Our situation's complicated here. Okay? I know I have to be careful what I say and how I say it. Know this. We have an enormous amount of help out there. And if there's an opening, I mean a genuine opening, where we won't be harmed, they will participate. They will come in to assist and offer mentorship. They will not fix this for us. Okay, they can't. We have to be vested in the outcome of humanity's future, or it's all for naught. Okay? And this is where we talk, this is where I want to go again with creating a domain of knowing. We have to be vested in creating humanity's future. And in one of the last interviews, or the last interview I did with Robert Potter, the first interview, or the last one that I've done, You know, we talked about knowing what you don't want. I mean, I haven't met anybody who doesn't know what they don't want. Okay.
Yeah, and, totally.
So, you know, now let's, and we have the world of what we don't want. Okay, we have a lot of that. Most of us are in that space. Every day we see what we don't want. Every day we experience what we don't want. So now what we need to do is, instead of focusing on that every day, because we're going to keep creating that, what we don't want, we need to begin the baby steps to start thinking about creating what we do want. And even if it's just one thing, and it could be something totally simple, okay? Like, I don't know, I want to be able to enjoy a banana split once a week. I realize it's probably a really lame thing. You know,
it's a suitable example.
Well, you know, it's something that brings comfort, something that brings joy. It could be just going for a drive by yourself and listening to your favorite music. It could be doing something with your children, whether it be a water park or just going for a walk in nature, or just doing something that's joyful, okay? And it doesn't have to cost money, but it's about intentionally creating that joy that in your life with focused intent. You're focusing now not on what you don't want, now you're beginning to focus on what you do want. And we have to start moving in this direction. No matter what's going on around us, no matter what's happening in the world, no matter how bad the news gets, we need to focus on what it is that we do want. Okay? And it can start small. It can be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes a day. It could be an afternoon, a weekend. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is, and you will know. You know what that is, okay? I don't know what that is. I know for me, okay? But for you, you need to focus on what that is. You really have to intentionally begin to pull that towards you. Because as there is negative, there is also positive. There is an enormous amount of positive energy coming to us, not only from other dimensions, but from the sun as well, okay? The sun is an enormous generator of dimensions. Use it. Empower yourself with it. Use your soul energy, that kinetic soul energy. All of this is only going to be more amplified as we begin to move down through the plasma field, the Oort cloud, as I think NASA calls it. Okay, it's plasma, it's electrical, it's extraordinary. The last time humanity's gone through this, it was, I believe, 52 or 26,000 years ago. We need to use it, we need to harness it, we need to focus on creating what we do want, a domain of knowing that we want, that is joy, that is love, that is humanity at peace with each other, regardless of the color or the creed. I mean, this is not rocket science. I mean, I am just flabbergasted at how quickly things can spiral out of control. You know, we have to figure this out. No one's going to come in and save us if we are not willing to commit ourselves to this progress. Okay, we need to meet them. We need to embrace this. We need to embrace this paradigm halfway. At least make the effort. Okay, there's not enough of us making the effort, and we have to do this intentionally. We have to truly intentionally decide this is what we're going to do. Now, that doesn't mean you go out and you save the world, because you can't necessarily do that, okay? But you can work on yourself. You can work on your loved ones by example. You can, when asked, what's different about you, explain to them, look, I've chosen this path. I am choosing to focus on joy, on love and joy and harmony, as opposed to, I hate my job, I hate my car, I hate everything. Okay? You got to let that go. We all have to let that go. And we need to focus on what we want. And we need to draw that to us. Focus on it. Make it happen, because it will. Make it happen. We have to push back on these pricks that are trying to control the world. Okay? They're not interested in our welfare. No, 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 no. They have their own agenda. They have their own domain of knowing. And basically it involves feeding off of our misery. I don't know about you, but I'm done with that. We should all be done with that. Okay? It has not worked. Look at the technological advances that humanity has had. Look at, whether you believe this or not, the technology that is off-world that was built on this planet. Look at the idea that we have this incredible space fleet of incredible men and women who are working out there that are detached from humanity. Why are they detached from humanity? Because they want to keep it a secret. They don't want us to know, because it would change our entire perspective as to who we are. It would actually empower humanity to know that this was real, that we could accomplish this. That should tell you everything about the agenda. Okay? We got to stop feeding these guys, these beings. We have to stop feeding them once and for all. Okay? Negativity, because that's what they want. That's what they're feeding off of. And we need to starve them out of here by creating joy. If everybody's okay, I'd like to take 2 minutes just to quench my thirst for a second. Would that be okay?
That would be fine, Alex. So bring up a little picture so that you can do that. Maybe I should put some music on.
And maybe we can come back and do Q&A. Would that be okay?
Yeah, we'll come back and do Q&A. Okay. Now, this is just some very peaceful music. This is by Puneet Yatri, Beneath the Angel's Wings. I think this is what I should do.
Just 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Good, I'm ready.
Okay, right. So let me just stop the music. There we go. And welcome back, everybody. Let me just come off so that people can see. There we go. I'm presenting to everybody. So On with the lights. Yes, it's my camera takes a few seconds to kind of come up. So anyway, so welcome to part two. This is a question and answer session, and I'm going to squint over here. So right, looking down here on my screen, I'm going to try and find. We won't have much time to answer all of these questions. So please, if you ask the question and it didn't get answered, well. Maybe it's been asked before, maybe it's been answered before. So we're trying to the first one is, can we do this again soon, please? Yes, we will. Right, okay. So now, where's all those questions gone? Here we are. Now, this is a very, very salient question. When you were talking on Project Camelot, a few years ago, you did a speech in front of a Project Camelot conference, and you talked about mentorship. So this is a question from Karen. In one of your previous interviews, you spoke about a mentorship with beneficial ETs or Andromedans. Do you think some of us who are waking up now can volunteer to be mentored to help humanity during this coming shift?
Absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, they would the groups, and it's not just the A's, it's many other groups, they wouldn't want it any other way, because that they have to do it this way in order for humanity to be invested in the future of humanity. Okay? It's just, I believe we're behind schedule here. We're a little bit behind schedule. Mm-hmm. But absolutely, that's exactly how it's going to be. Now, there are clusters, there are star groups, or soul groups of people who come from different places. I mean, you know, your soul wasn't created on Earth. This is not your first lifetime in physicality. No one here. You know, you choose your level of consciousness to come in here and have an experience. That's just what it is, and no denial will ever change that. It just, people have chosen a specific path, a group of lessons, experiences, etc., and that's what it is, and that's how it's going to work. So yes, people, as this thing progresses, and however that's going to be, people will be given an opportunity to do that. Absolutely. It won't happen any other way.
Thank you. Thank you. Because this is like the bringing together of all the star groups, so you know, all the people spreading out as a kind of tree network of people who are awakening each other. That's the feeling, anyway. So one mentors and then another mentors. You know, you mentor a group and they mentor others. Yeah,
that's exactly right. Each, you know, one. Those who know, you know, they can teach what they know. If you just read it in a book, you can't. You know, you only know about it. That's how it works. You know?
Fantastic. Okay, so now here's let's talk let's go over from the knowledge. Right. So here's the part of the big fear thing, and this is money. Money is all about fear. Here's a question. There's a couple of questions, and I'm going to bring them all together. You know, from Ganga, she's saying, how can we disempower the monetary system on a personal level? Any suggestions from the A's? But then is also, do you feel that an economic collapse is imminent in conjunction to the elevation of frequencies? Can you tell us about the process of money and how it's going to transform in our space, and how we can make it transform in our space? How's that as a question?
Well, the way money was set up was set up as a control mechanism here, or a medium of exchange. It lost its fairness to do good a long time ago, at least on the big picture. It's, you know, now it's all about creating debt, which is control. Now, is an economic collapse? I mean, I hear about it as well. I also hear about the new currency system that's coming in. I think there's a lot of truth to both of those things. I believe there is a new system coming in that's asset-backed, and I believe the fiat currency system is going away. And it has to, because it's not real. I think as humanity evolves consciously, we will begin to realize we don't need money, that money is not necessary for us to live with each other or together, that we will create another way that doesn't give someone else control over our everyday life. Because as it is now, through governments, through banks, they've basically got a control on everything we do, and they're doing their best to outlaw everyday life. Everything we do could be a crime. And for what? Why do something like this? And it's all about control. JP, someone is trying to get into my computer. Someone is trying to get into my computer. I have all of my security alarms going off.
Oh, wow. That's interesting. Well,
it is interesting.
Hello, everybody. You're still coming through here.
Okay, I've given you an FYI. I don't know what's going to happen here.
That's okay. So, well, that's fine. Tell them. Well, let's just ask our friends upstairs if they would take care of this, shall we? While we ask the next question, which is, and thank you for that answer. Oh, this is a beautiful question. This is from Marie. Are the Andromedans in touch with Earth as a being, and how may we best align with her wishes for, and I'm going to reverse her saying, herself and humanity?
By being quiet, by being still, by actually just engaging, you know, in whatever method that you choose to do, if you engage and connect to your soul, you will automatically connect to her, because there's a symbiotic relationship. We're all connected anyway. It's just not focusing on the noise, the white noise. Instead, it's focusing on what you feel, how you feel, wanting joy. And you know, there's a million ways to do that, to connect to the earth, you know. You just have to want to do it, you know, just ask yourself. Yourself already knows most of the answers. You know, most of us just don't listen. We're listening to our subconscious all the time, you know, and all it's paying attention to is the white noise, you know, because that's what it's vibrating to. We need to, you know, raise our vibrations and start tuning into a resonance that brings us joy, that allows us the space to focus on what we want, not on what we don't want.
So do you think everybody should just... one of the things that I do...
Yes. The answer is yes.
Every day, do something slightly further.
Sorry? They all are. They all understand that the Earth is a living being, even the regressives, okay, and AI, they understand that. They can't truly identify because they don't have soul, but they do realize that it's a consciousness. What they do is they try to tweak it. They try to tweak it to fit their mold, their agenda, by doing things to it, suppressing the energy, or trying to harm it in some way, so that it will respond to what their wishes are. That's how it works.
So this is some people might describe that as changing the geometry of the planet. Could that be spoken like that? Like a distortion of geometry?
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yes, that's a very good analogy. You know, if a soul is placed in a body in one way and you're able to tweak it just a little bit, then that body is in distress.
Uh-huh. Alex, have we lost you? Yes. Well, we seem to have lost Alex's connection there. Don't know what's happened there. If that's so, we will bring him in by mobile phone. Right. Okay. So let's just bring him in there. So first of all, I'm going to try and figure out this screen share thing because I've got the right. Okay, so here's a. I have a picture. I had a picture of Alex somewhere. No. All right, this is what I'm going to put at the end anyway. So there you go. Let me just stop presenting and present this for the moment. And then we'll try and call Alex back in after another lovely piece of music from Puneet Jhatri, Above the Clouds. Hi. So, right. The black screen of death. Okay, well, Alex, you are still on
the... Can we finish this by phone?
Yeah, we're still on the call. As long as you've got charge on your phone, we can, take it till the end. So let's just...
Okay, let's do it.
Yeah, we're not messing about here, so let's not waste time. This is... okay. All right, so here's another question about the 4D and 3D. How do reptilians from the 4D come and stay in the 3D, and how are they able to look like humans?
Well, they have technology. They have technology that basically creates a holograph around them. And my understanding is what they do is they will use certain genetic lines that are reptilian, that they will, specific body forms, body types, that's what they will do to make themselves appear real. There are also some that can't physically be here, but what they will do is they will attach themselves spiritually to someone. And it's typically someone who is a very major a drug user, such as heroin, morphine, things like that, where their body, their soul, energy field is very weak. And what they will do is they will attach to it, and then they will feed off of that. It's like an attachment, a spiritual attachment. That's a very complicated answer. But they do. As we start going through the plasma field, and the vibration of the earth rises, they will not be able to sustain themselves. And in fact, the earth has risen enough that some of them have had to already leave. They couldn't sustain themselves in this environment.
And that segues nicely into the next question from Junjun. I've been hearing about waves of energy coming in September, October. What is your or the A's perspective on what has been dubbed Wave X?
Okay, well, I don't technically know about Wave X.
I think they're referring to the photon belt or, the thing that we're
exactly
doing. You know.
That's exactly right. And we're already in it, not to mention the fact that, when benevolent ships come in close to the Earth and they burn those holes in the electronic sense, it's trying to isolate us from the rest of the galaxy. We get galactic energy through those holes as well. The good guys are putting a full court press on the regressive energy that's here, and basically what they're trying to do is they can't. Some of the groups agreed to leave, and they did. But there's those hardcore groups, they won't. So the only way to get them to go without harming humanity or blowing everybody's mind is to raise the vibration of the planet and humanity itself and literally starve them so they have to leave. They have nowhere to go, or they're going to die. They're just going to die here.
So when you have a parasite, you starve its food, like you starve the sugar. So and this is really the whole thing about how to get rid of the reptilians is you don't fund them, you don't pay them any attention, they don't, you don't give them the louche that they're this you know that they're draining.
Sure, let's focus on the questions. Okay, I know there's probably a lot of them.
Sure. Okay, so let's go very sideways. Considering the new weirdness, were the children of Cleopatra the Seventh interwoven into the Church of Rome mythology?
My perspective is that the offspring of Cleopatra is the Holy Grail. And that is the line that the Vatican has been trying to hunt down and kill all these years. And that's what the Templars knew about.
And that's the holy relic that they're guarding is the bloodline. Okay, thank you. All right, so there's you touched on the AI. Param is asking, please comment on the Andromedan perspective of the use of artificial intelligence on our planet, in our galaxy, in the universe, and the artificial intelligent, you know, extraterrestrials.
Okay, let me just add one more thing to the last question. Ladies and gentlemen, the bloodline always follows the mother, not the father. Follows the mother. Now, can you ask that question one more time? The new one?
Okay, sorry about that. Thank you, and thank you for
that
expansion there. Can you comment on the Andromedan perspective on the use of artificial intelligence on our planet, in our galaxy, in the universe? And as a corollary, could you talk about the artificial intelligence that's trying to invade our minds? If they're...
Okay. Great question. My understanding is that artificial intelligence on some levels can be used and is used, but its interaction with humanity is somewhat limited in the sense that when you're doing, whether it's mining or terraforming or ship repair, building of craft, even those, let's say you have a ship, here's a perfect example. Let's use the Black Knight satellite. Okay, the one that was broken had someone artificial found it. What they would have done was they would have used artificial intelligence to go out and repair the ship, because even though they may have a biological body, they are still able to function that way. And go through very extreme regions of space or very hostile environments to go in and perform a mission. Okay? But their roles are extremely limited, and so is their programming. It isn't where they would go out and say, okay, you go out and create a universe, or you go out and create a planet. So the level of artificial intelligence that is involved in our galaxy now, the only thing I know and the only thing that I could ever get out of them was that it was brought here from someplace else. And it was not supposed to be here. It was an invasion.
And how did we, have we coped with the invasion, or have we just absorbed it, or is it latent? What's the state of play with that?
Oh no, it's out in the open now, but it took a long time for everybody to recognize it. Because it was hiding.
Right. And
but they all know now, you know, and again, some of it has a place. It is not by its very nature regressive, but if it's tweaked by someone with the intention of creating it to do harm or to suppress or to, you know, kill, that's a whole different story. Okay. But artificial intelligence had to have been created in the beginning by a non-artificial intelligence source.
Get you.
It's programmed.
Get you. And
it's originally programmed by someone who has soul.
And is this what they call the black goo?
Well, my understanding is that is, well, I don't know that all artificial intelligence is a black goo, so no, I would say no. But the black goo that people have seen, and I know that they discovered it in the Falklands underground, and also in the Dark Knights use it, that is basically an artificially intelligent software. That's what that is. It's software. It's a liquid software.
Yes, and very interesting. Thank you for that. Okay, so here's let's just motor on through as many as we can. This is from Sue. Do the Andromedans ever work with the reptilians for the good of humanity? You know, do they have a bad rap? You know, are there some good ones?
Yes, there are. Yeah, there are some good ones who, you know, vibrate at a higher frequency. Absolutely. You know, they're not all bad. In fact, many of the lower levels, they have at one time or another rebelled because they didn't want to go along with the program, because as they were going in and enslaving other star systems, they themselves were becoming enslaved. And at some point, many of them realized that their life was a direct reflection of what they were doing to others. And what they were looking at, as far as a suppressed race, is exactly who they had become. So yeah, I mean the game of fear, dominance, control, using other races as a natural resource, that's all coming to an end. Okay, unfortunately, the remnants of all that old empire stuff, or you know whatever you want to call it, Orion War stuff. The remnants of it, which is being cleaned up now, is in our third density frequency band.
Excellent. Thank you. Let's now just segue that. Do the Andromedans, this is from Pear, do the Andromedans refer to universal lore, such as universal rules of intention and agreements? And I think he means something like the Prime Directive, as in Star Trek sort of thing.
No, not exactly. I've never heard it that way, or I've never really necessarily heard them use the expression universal law, because, you know, they're telepathic. Their language is far more extensive than ours. They would not refer to it that way, other than the fact that they realize that we are all interconnected. And if you remember early in the information when I first started speaking 25 years ago, the reason they all showed up or began paying attention to our solar system is because tyranny shows up in their future. So, no, they genuinely care about evolving races, but they also, whether they're benevolent or not, they all sort of have their own agendas too. You know, they're all looking for their self best interests, and, if it's to their self-interest to help us, to make us evolve, because it's going to make everyone else stronger and freer, which is the way they choose to live, then I think that that's where they're going to go. That's exactly what I think. I mean, you know, do I know every single intention? No, I don't know. But I know that they're here to help, and many of the other races that are involved, they're absolutely committed to seeing this program through, to make sure that this albatross that's been around our neck for thousands and thousands and thousands of years is released, is done, it's ended. So, you know, at this point, they're pretty much in awe of us, and I think they really genuinely want to see us be able to stand on our own two feet, you know, speaking in that way.
Okay. And this is, I'm trying to group some of the questions here. So you might find a composite question here. This is about CERN. Tomorrow, they're cranking the thing up. they're spinning two magnetic fields in opposite directions, which, as we all know, opens a dimensional portal. How do you think CERN will play out is the thing, and do you know their intention? What I mean, because like you say, the lie is different at every level. What do you think are the different levels that they're lying to us on? What do you think is their true intention for this?
For CERN?
Yeah, for CERN.
As far as the lie in different levels, I'm not sure exactly what they've been told. But I believe, and this is my own personal opinion, is that they've been given a toy and they really think that they're looking for something else, even though it may turn out to be something else. I think that they've given us many toys that we didn't know really what to do or how to use, knowing that we're an enormously curious and a driven race to want to know more. I think that they have taken advantage of that in some cases, and we may be messing with something that we absolutely shouldn't. I will tell you this, that if something goes very badly awry or goes wrong, don't be surprised if it just shuts down, it breaks down, or they just take the whole thing away. It just like goes away. It vanishes. Because they are not going to, the benevolence I'm talking about, they are not going to let these idiots do something stupid that hurts all of us, or even hurts other star systems, other races, and creates other problems within their density. Here they're trying to patch it up and heal it and raise its frequency. They're not going to let anyone interfere with that any longer. So we'll have to see. We'll have to see how it plays out. I honestly don't know at this point. But I was told that they were trying to merge timelines, and that simply isn't going to be allowed. In fact, it's already been shut down.
Thank you. Merging timelines. Do you want to? Is this to do with what Dan Burrish was talking about several years ago? And the Project Yellow Book, where they kept seeing, they had this device that they could look into the future and it kept on flickering from one future to another, very different futures. Is that what you're talking about just then?
Yes. Those were artificial timelines. Okay, where we are is an original real-time timeline. And this is where the changes are going to be. This is where we're going to evolve. They're not going to let anybody out of here. That is trying to escape. Okay? This is where it ends for the regressive forces that are here. It ends in this timeline.
And does that mean that it ends the future that everybody was living in? The future that everybody was living in.
What future is that? We're creating that as we speak.
Exactly. So the one that the people came back from doesn't exist anymore then?
No, it doesn't.
So where do they come from now? And why are they still here? How come people from the future are still here? There's the question. Or have they died? You know, is this why people die and leave the planet?
Do we have another question?
All right. Okay. So, some great names. Magdalena. Did we really have 12-strand DNA when we were first created? Will we eventually recover all of our potential?
Yes, but it won't happen in this lifetime for us. It will probably be 5 to 10 generations from now that the body will be allowed to heal itself and restore itself to its original dynamic. As mentorship begins and the environment is cleaned and all the pollutants and all the chemicals and all those things that make us sick every day and healing modalities that come that are involved with light, sound, color, when those things are allowed to be used here in humanity, humanity will begin to heal itself. And it will take several generations, many generations, in fact, before humanity will get back to that particular level. It won't happen for us.
Right. That's interesting. So, okay, I've been reading, watching a fellow called Chris Thomas, who's a Welsh psychic, and he's been talking about these characters called the Vaelon. Have you heard of this? I mean, he's talking about a mind pipe. Another fourth dimensional thing, they use time travel to create themselves a reality, that they're the Anunnaki. I don't know. Are you aware of this? This thread of history or story?
No, I'm not.
Okay,
not at all.
Let's move on. Okay, then. From Debriel, would you explain a bit further about the differences between the masculine energies and feminine energies that we are moving into, and how that will manifest and affect us? Great question.
Okay, well, we're moving out of the masculine energy into the feminine principle, which of course is nurturing and more healing. And if you were to look at the galaxy as a plate, on the top part of the plate where you would currently put your food, that would rest as the masculine. That which is underneath where the food goes would be the feminine. We're crossing that plate plane, and we're moving down into the feminine. This happens to help heal humanity. And what it also does is it reunites humanity, because we move back to the feminine principle and we let go of the war principle. Now, you have to understand that during the time of Atlantis, after many of the races left in the war that occurred during Atlantis, we were offered protection, but that protection never manifested. So really rogue and aggressive groups came in here and basically tweaked humanity, okay, in the worst kind of a way. That's all going away. And you know, they had their run. It's over. And so that's what has to happen. JP, they're knocking at the window. I have to, my time is up. I have to give up the conference room.
Alex, well, thank you so much. It's been a fantastic time.
Gosh, you know, I want to do this again, because I know, and maybe we can just do a Q&A.
Yeah.
Because I so enjoy the Q&A.
Yeah. Okay. What we might do is we can get together maybe on a regular basis, because I tell you, people pour questions into me. And you know, they have been doing since our interview in 2012 or whatever, you know. People send me the occasional, can you ask Alex this? Can you ask Alex that? So thank you so much for your
JP,
grace.
JP, will you wrap it up for me, folks?
Yes, indeed.
I have to get out of the room.
So,
thank you so much. I love all of you. And let's do this again. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Alex. Thank you very much. We'll be right back.